I remember I was with a bunch of friends and we're at a bus station, and it was late at night, and one person got stabbed. Somebody that we didn't know got stabbed. And I remember sort of taking care of this person because we didn't really know what to do. And I felt sort of helpless. I didn't know what more to do other than apply pressure, tell him that we're going to get help and things like that. And at that point, I thought, you know, being a doctor might be very useful and also would be very fulfilling as a career. I'm Dr. Peter Lin. I'm a family doctor here in Toronto, Canada. And part of my role as family physician is looking after all these patients, but I also do education for family physicians as well. And I'm also part of the columnist for health for CBC as well, in terms of educating the public. As a family physician, the key things that we're doing is looking after people. We're actually trying to prevent diseases from happening. So if you start off with babies, for example, so we're constantly doing their well baby checks and we're doing their immunizations and things like that. As people get older, we try to make sure that they don't get into drugs, alcohol, make sure that they don't get sexually transmitted diseases. As they get older, we don't want them having heart attacks, we don't want them having, you know, strokes, those kinds of things. So we start looking at blood pressure and cholesterol. So because we're in family practice, we sort of see the whole gamut of the patient as they grow from baby to sort of the elderly stages. And that's kind of a lot of fun, and sometimes it cycles back on itself, where, you know, I took care of this baby, the baby has now grown to the point where they get married and they have a child, and now I'm looking after their baby. So it's a lot of fun being in family practice to be able to do that. And you would have to come specifically? I mean, initially when you're not in medicine, you sort of look at doctor as being, wow, it's very, you know, glorified kind of thing or fancy kind of stuff. But really, when you get into the practice of medicine, it's a lot of just grind work, you know, like you're seeing lots of patients. You have to do lots of paperwork. There's an awful lot of things to write down. So that's the grind that I think most people don't see. And you know, on television, you see the, you know, running around, the excitement of medicine. And I think the reality is that there's just a lot of hard work that goes in. And I think that portion of things, people, like in general people, not in medicine, may not be so aware of, that, you know, their family doctor is maybe staying until, you know, 10 o'clock at night, trying to finish charts, trying to write the disability forms for their patients. And that portion of it has never been shown, because who would be interested in that, right? So the Hollywood movies and things like that are sort of showing the sort of the glorified kind of things, whereas the reality is there's just a lot of hard work that has to go into it every single day.
Good, the eye looks good. So no more crossing the stands on this one for me.
The back of the in family head, practice, so you end up looking after all sorts of different diseases. So, you know, one minute you're a respirologist looking after lung problem, next minute you're a gynecologist, next minute you're a pediatrician. And so you have to sort of keep up with all of these things. So each field is moving, and so therefore you have to keep up with what the information is, what you're supposed to be doing, and then you're constantly changing hats. So it's challenging, but at the same time it's interesting, right? So every 10, 15 minutes, you're seeing something different and you're using your brain in a different way. But I think the most challenging thing is just managing your time in order to make sure that you see your patients, you do all the charts, you do all the paperwork, and on top of that, you try to stay up with the information so that you're not sort of being left behind in a particular area of medicine. So a typical day for me, let's say on the days that I'm playing doctor only, would be very early. I get to the office around 7 in the morning, and I get here so that I can do all the paperwork. So there's lots and lots of paperwork to be done. And then I will start seeing patients probably like 8:30 or 9-ish, and then I'll continue on for the day. And so that's usually my doctoring kind of day. On the days where I'm doing CBC, for example, where we have talking to the hosts about a particular topic, so whatever's hot that week, we talk about that topic, and I'll speak to, let's say, you know, 15 or 20 stations in the morning. I will show up at the CBC at around 5 in the morning. I'll go until about 9:30, covering from the East Coast going all the way across, and then I'll come to the office, and then I'll see patients. And then at the end of the day, once you finish writing all your charts and everything else, then usually I'll go off and we'll do a dinner meeting with some of the doctors, you know, talking about cholesterol, blood pressure, Alzheimer's disease, something like that. And then I'll finally get home sort of around 10-ish at night, and then the cycle begins again sort of the next day.
So the good news is that your bone is okay,
yeah,
because when I turn your hip, it's fine. Whereas if it's cracked, it wouldn't turn like that. So I think the hip part is okay.
Yeah.
The only part that I'm worried about is because it's the edge of a stair. Like if you fell on your bum,
Yeah.
It's very hard to break something when you fall on your bum, but when you hit the edge of a stair, we just have to be careful. Okay. So we'll take just a simple
communication for me is sort of cornerstone, because it's no good having the information trapped in my head or in a journal or in a specialist's head. What we need to do is get that to the person that needs to use that information. So I think in my office, if I can explain things well to the patient, now the patient becomes like a partner. So I don't have to call all the shots. It's kind of like having a co-pilot. Yeah. So I could be the main pilot, but it's nice if the co-pilot kind of knows what's going on as well.
Good job. Go get your blood done and then we'll touch base after.
Have a happy day.
All right, you too. Okay, see you later.
If you want to be a family doctor, go hang out with your family doctor and say, hey, can I shadow you for a day just to see what it's like? And don't get too disappointed when it's kind of boring, because that's what it's going to be like as you move forward. Let's say you want to be a cardiologist, then maybe you can go to the hospital and say, you know, can I shadow or can I talk to somebody? I think that's helpful. So I think talking to people or actually seeing how an office runs would be very helpful. So volunteering is a very helpful way to see if you like it. Now, it's difficult because a lot of times, you know, students are saying, well, I don't really know what specialty is. So usually we group it into three. So family practice, surgery, and internal medicine. So sort of the medical side of things, operating kind of things, and then family practice. And a lot of people will say, oh no, I don't want anything to do with surgery, you know, and so now kind of narrows it down for you along the way. And then whatever organ that you think you like, so let's say you're fascinated by the heart, then maybe cardiology or a cardiac surgeon, that would be the kind of things you're, or you're fascinated by the brain, and so therefore you're thinking about neurology or psychiatry or something like that. So you could see that the organ that fascinates you will then become the specialty. Or you might say, look, I want to look after everything from babies to old people. That would be family practice. So think it through in that way so that it's a little bit more logical than saying, I just want to be a doctor, for example.
So this is what I do all the time.
Just remember that there will be lots of dark days. So during your training time, there will be times where you haven't had enough sleep. And it's the motivation to help patients. I think that's what keeps you going. Because when patients come in, they're scared, they're confused, they're feeling ill, they're not well. If they can leave there feeling better, happier, understand things better, or hopeful, I think that's part of our job. I've had patients where both of us know that it's a terminal illness and that we can't really correct it, but they still come in and see me and they still feel better and I feel better. So I think the motivation of why you want to go in is what keeps you going. Even though you're sort of running out of gas, I guess, if you will, at the end of the day.
What advice can you offer to students who'd like to follow in your footsteps?
Don't.
That's a loaded question.